Forecasting using data. It's not unusual when you put forecasting or metrics in a title at a user group that you halve the attendance. So this is good. I know you normally get about 90 odd people. You are the hardcore people, my people. I have this little location on the web, bit.ly sim resources, capital S, capital R. It contains everything I've ever done, really. It's got a lot of spreadsheets and a lot of exercises and a lot of single page PDFs, which operate as my long-term memory on topics. It's geeky. I was married very late in life. And you'll know why when you see all the stuff that I've produced. I'll let you check that out at some point. So everything I show you, if I start going off topic and pulling up spreadsheets, you have access to at that location. So it'll come up regularly. But first of all, my background is in numbers. One of the things I do a lot of thing is my mother asks, you know, you get that eternal question, what do you really do? I don't know what you do. Yeah, puff on a cigarette. Yeah. What do you do? What do you do? I teach mathematics to executives. I try and teach them that there's a way of putting a forecast and a number on things they need to do, and they need to do that if they want to make better decisions. And what I've learned over the years is everything you've learned about statistics in schools, you have to forget. We're just taught very poorly about... We make statistics into a mathematical field, and it's really a logic field. It's really about, you know, what's the chance of something happening over above something else, or, you know, I run this course for school students where we work out the probability of being a car accident if you're texting versus not texting. Putting it into context, we don't ever talk about standard deviation or any other higher math. So I think some of you have already done the first exercise, which is, it seems simple, there's just a six-sided die, and it's just teaching you what a probability is. You all have done that, have you? Did you all get a chance to do it, or do you need 2 minutes to finish that one off? It seems remarkably simple, but in putting this sheet together, and I've had it for about a year, there have been six mistakes in my answers over the years, because even I just sort of rattled them off, oh, this is, yeah, 40% and 20% and 60%. I got six questions wrong out of six questions out of eight. So it gets a little bit confusing. So tonight can go one of two ways. We can do the paper exercises with Di, or you can start throwing questions at me about forecasting and software projects and things like that, and I can show you how to answer them. So who wants to do the dice spreadsheets? And you got a couple of people, okay, and a couple of others. Well, I'll split the difference. We'll do one of the exercises on here, and then when the pizza comes, I will work with anyone who wants to do the other exercises to actually get through them. But a lot of people have already done it. Now, so this is the one you were doing. Remember, probability is just about... what are the total number of possible outcomes? Like everything you can think of? Like on a coin, how many outcomes on a coin? Three. There's another one if you toss the coin and you can't find it. So if you ever in a bet, sort of, you must say, if it's heads, I win. Because then if it's tails or lost, the other person wins. So you've got to be careful. So... be really careful about probabilities. There's always the case you haven't seen yet. And in our world, in software, when we start looking at cycle times and getting throughput bits of data, there's always one you haven't seen yet. So there's always an extra one on the top end, an extra one on the bottom end that you don't really know about. But mostly we ignore that and just sort of say, when you toss a coin, please be careful. Okay, so I gave you 3 minutes to do that. You've all done it? That's good. All right. All right. So standard statistics, no matter what measure you have, there's a way that we often abbreviate measures and aggregate them by average or mean. And then you sort of can mislead with these numbers quite well. So this is what we're trying to avoid. Whenever we abbreviate numbers and history by either a mean or a median, or when we try and aggregate a large number of data into a single number, we lose data. We lose information about what's actually happening. Now, when we start using a regression line on a burndown chart, or when we take the average velocity and divide it by the number of stories in the background, we're at the mercy of mean and its possible problems. So when we actually go and do a forecast that we want to get a bit more insight into, what we really need to do is capture as many possible outcomes as there could be, and then work out how much risk we want to take on. So a normal coin toss, so with a normal burndown chart or a regression line or any traditional method that uses division to work out a number, you're really getting the 50% point. So whether your project is early or late is a line ball call. It's 50-50. What we really need to do is to stack the odds a bit more in our favor. And that's what probabilistic forecasting does. Nothing more than that. What it does is just allow us to work out a buffer in a realistic fashion so that we can hit the outcome more often than we miss the outcome. That's all this is about. So I thought to myself, could I make a tool which made this Troy proof? Something that sort of could get people an on-ramp to actually do this. And I sort of did. Bitly throughput forecaster, if you want to sort of grab it yourself. And let's go have a look at that. If I was more organized, I would have already brought these up, but you're getting me, not a professional speaker. So this is it, throughput forecaster. Now, I'm going to go through just roughly how a session might go with a team or a company. What's the number one thing that makes your project forecast wrong? Underestimating. Underestimating others? Probably estimating, whatever. The bloody start date. Apologies to YouTube. You can bleep that out. The start date. Everyone worries about how big the stories are. Are they 8 or are they 5? No, that one's a 5, right? And they all get all this emotional sort of stuff. And they put together this perfect forecast. And then it sits, people sit around for a while. Well, I don't know if we should do that project. I need the team somewhere else. This other project's running long. So you don't have a team. So that start date is your number one error in your forecast. And when I say, you got to come up with your own definition of what start means. And to me, it means I can physically touch the team. They're here. They're not just a requisition. They're not just sort of off trekking Nepal, but they'll be back soon, right? They're actually present. They have everything they need to do their work, like a desk, computers, the ability to talk to each other in some form or fashion, and then some knowledge about what they're going to be asked to do. If any of those three things aren't in place, you have started in no way other than on paper. So often the start date that you really want to start a forecast from, you have to be a bit more careful about how you choose. So the next thing you need to do is a rough amount of work that you're going to do. And I've used the word guess intentionally here, 20 to 30 stories. Now, those 20 to 30 stories in the backlog are pretty much the starting point for the amount of work you have to do. Does anyone ever have defects in their code? All right, does sometimes work that you choose to pull into a sprint get split? Yep. This is the number one thing that's missed. Whenever we use any rate or pace that's captured in our completed list, it's in kilometers per hour. The work in our backlog is in miles per hour. So if we actually appear to be moving faster than we are. So if we go and use the completed pace and just work out how long it would take to burn down what's in our backlog, we will be wrong. And in my experience, we're wrong somewhere between 1 and 3 times. It doesn't take much. That means some stories get split. Some stories don't get split at all. Some stories get split in 2, and some stories get split into 3. It might be 1 defect plus a split, something like that. But it's never 1-to-1. There's always going to be a conversion from the backlog into the completed list. So you've got to account for it. And now it's a new team and we really haven't got any history on them. So we don't really know what pace they're going to burn through the work. So really we've got to sit back and think, well, would you guys be embarrassed if you couldn't get one item done a week? You know, yeah, we'll get one item done a week. Let's make sure we size our stories to get at least one thing done. And how many of them are, how many of developers do we have? You know, maybe 2? Well, how many things are you going to get done in a week? Well, the maximum we'll get done is 2 things. Let's bump it up. Let's just say we're going to get between 1 and 5 things done per week as a team. And that's all there is to it. So what happens now is this spreadsheet has no macros in it. This is just purely driven by formulas. There's nothing in here that's programmatic. Everything in here you can see is the formulas. But what it does is it starts between 20 stories, somewhere between multiplied by somewhere between 1 and 3, because we said that's how much the backlog might split. So starting at a random point between those bounds, it hypothetically picks a throughput number week after week and does a hypothetical burn down chart. Eventually they all hit the boundaries. This is my projects. I happen to start off with the worst amount of scope and I happen to have the team that moved the slowest. So you see that there's it's out here somewhere, it's on the wall. And then you see the team which has happened to get start off with the lowest scope and get the fastest throughput samples ended up very early on. And this is the most complex thing that there is in statistics. This was the very first reason that the first computer was built, was to do a Monte Carlo forecast exactly like this. All it did, instead of insert how many electrons and protons would be generated when we squash a piece of plutonium. That couldn't be solved through measurement because it killed the people doing the measurement. So they did it instead in computer and they simulated it. Of course, they didn't have actual data about what would happen. So they hypothetically said, we think that when we squash it this much, every electron would be, you know, generate 2 neutrons and protons and stuff like that. And then they sort of calculated a range of possible results. And they sort of said, we're 80% sure that this thing will go bang. And that's what they did. So if you ever look up Enrico Fermi and anything that about the Manhattan Project, they did that, exactly that. Not close to that, exactly that. They just used different sort of way of combining the formulas. They didn't use guess, I imagine. They were too professional. So essentially what happens there is you end up with the ability to sort of say, out of 1,000 Excel rows, 850 of them finished on or before the 9th of the 9th. Now this will be superior to anything you're doing currently in forecasting, unless you do something like this, because traditionally we would have only been able to sort of assume that it was going to finish on the 5th of August. Yeah, that's right, the 5th of August. I'm sorry about the date format. I'm not used to it either. I originally come from Australia, but I moved to the US. And my wife is sick of me missing dental appointments because I can't get the dates right. So you understand the rough where we're going here. We've got that. Now the team starts working. They start doing their work. Well, what we actually get then is actual data. They got 3 stories done. They got 5 stories done, 2 stories done, 1 story done, 5 stories done, and a big 0. Nice duck. Can't use that joke in the US. So they managed to, what we can do now, once we get real data, we can start making this forecast use the actual data rather than our initial estimate. And now we're managing to get an updated forecast that we're running a little bit slower than we thought we were. This stuff will not be right. But it only has to be better than what you're currently doing, and it only has to tell you earlier that you're off your plan. So that's why we are, you really want to come in here and keep an actual count of the stories remaining in your backlog. And then that's the orange line, which already showed you where we're probably in trouble. There's a lot more possible outcomes out on that right-hand side than you would expect. So this is one spreadsheet that I have. There's about another 10 in there that do sort of variations of this. But this is probabilistic forecasting of software projects. It's only superior on account of it actually allows you to be a bit more broader with these guesses here and then actually get real data, narrow it in. Is anyone doing this?
Bit of a range.
So based on from where we are, it's sort of scaling up. Yeah. So this sort of plays out more scenarios to work out what that fan would actually be. Okay. So now, having said that, none of this works. None of this matters. And even if there's anything happening on your sort of style of forecast, any other way you do it. Because in the real world, what actually happens is there's things that go wrong. Has anyone had any performance problems that have stopped them launching in their software? Anyone got to the end and found out it didn't work on IE6 or Safari? Right. Anyone ever had security come down and sort of say, oh, this we put this live and now we're infected with these viruses? Like, has anyone had any security flaws? Has anyone... things like that are very constant. And they're the things that happen near the end of the project and we find out about them late. And what they are, they're things which may go wrong, and if they do, we're going to have to do extra work to fix it. You know, it's too slow, so now we have to code up how we're going to connect to an index server. We thought Bitcoin was going to be a thing, but it turned out it wasn't. We put in all that Euro support, and now we have to take it out. There's just saying, things like that happen, right? So what ends up impacting these forecasts more than the original work or arguing about the estimate of that work are these factors. Now, not all of you will be impacted by them, but some of you have and will be again. And this is what tends to happen. You sort of say there's, at the start, you say there's a, let's just say there's a 25% chance that we're going to get hit by performance. And if there is, how much work is there to put in an index server? Well, the original project was 20 to 30 stories. Let's say there's another 10 to 15 stories worth of work. And what we ends up happening here is we look even worse off, because now 25% of the time, these burn down lines will include the chance of having to do that risk. What's the value of getting rid of this risk? Well, with the risk in place, let's just come in here on the risks and put the risk in at just 100%. So it happens all the time. In which case, the date is the 4th of November. Can someone remember that? Someone smarter than me. If we got rid of that risk completely, What's the value on that date there? It's roughly about the 14th or the 10th. What was the first number? So it's about half a month's worth of, three quarters of a month's worth of work. You're roughly about saving about a month if it was on or off. But often in case you need to add a bit of financial power to the argument. So what's that month cost you in market cost of delay? If, say, it's you're going to be fined $1 million if you're not live for the Christmas sales season. If say it's $1 million, if you can, you can and should use $1 million to eliminate that risk if you've got it. And oftentimes it's just about forcing another team to do it or getting prioritized. You have a much more better chance of going into someone's room and sort of saying, this is going to cost us $1 million if it doesn't happen. So I really think you should consider prioritizing this above changing the logo color to blue. And they go, oh, okay, we'll do that. But you have to start putting the arguments about and understanding these risks and things that go wrong so you understand how much you should invest on fixing them. And a lot of the times you come in and sort of say, well, if we don't do refactoring, it's going to cause us to get slower near the end, and then we're not certain we can fix defects fast enough. But you should probably add a risk for that. And it might be something like, so that one was 25%. It might be another one that there's a 40% chance that we're going to have to do that refactoring anyway because it's so unstable. And it might only be between 5 and 10 stories. But now what you can sort of do, and you can sort of start saying things that by doing that refactoring of 5 to 10 stories, that halves our risk of having a performance problem. So now you're starting to understand what's really going to cause the projects to run long, and you're able to simulate and work out roughly, if we don't do this refactoring, where it got twice the exposure to a performance problem near the end of the project. So these are the type of things that you can do with a very simple spreadsheet. You've just got to start talking about the what can go wrong more than whether it's a 5 or an 8 point story.
It's 4 and 5.
Or 4 and unnumbered. It's the sheet where you actually get to do your own burndown charts. Now, you can do this while I'm speaking. You can sort of do it, but what it does is it gives you a bit of a practical exercise about how that chart about all those hypothetical burndowns, you get to create one yourself. The spreadsheet is doing nothing more than what you're doing on this spreadsheet. If the job was to work out how long is it going to take to finish 20 stories, then all you're doing is I'm just using a six-sided die to give you a random number between 1 and 6 to represent you might get between 1 story finished a week or 6 stories finished per week. Not my teams, but yeah, your teams might do that. It's heard of. And then what you're doing is you're rolling the dice, subtracting it from 20, say you got 6, say you got 1, it's my team again. Next one's 19, then you roll another one and 18, 17, and when you get to 0, you stop. And all you're doing is every one of those is a possible outcome that could have occurred. All you do is count the number of lines on or before a certain date. Put a start date on now, and week 1, week 2, week 3, week 4, you can convert it to a calendar date. So that's all that spreadsheet does. Is it works out how long in duration it's going to take to finish the project 1,000 times using random numbers about how much is going to be finished each week. And then it counts the number of lines on or before a certain date and says if there's 850 outcomes that finished by August or earlier, 85% chance. Cool. Now I wish I hadn't started that hamburger. So a couple of questions came up in the break. One was, but Troy, that doesn't account for different size stories. Like if you do story point estimations, you might have some 12s. Is that right? What would I have? Yeah. Some 13s or some 5s or 8s. And does it matter? Well, the answer is it depends. And I'll give you the cases for and against. With throughput, different size stories have already been characterized by some weeks being faster and some weeks being smaller in the number of stories completed. So in that case, as long as the same proportion of, you know, 5, 3, 8, 13 point stories continues, then you're not getting any extra value out of the story point estimates. So here's what I do. That spreadsheet works with counts or velocity. You've just got to be consistent. So wherever I put things in are called throughput, you can put velocity in. Wherever I said stories, you can put points in. Do both. If you've got the estimates, forecast it with the estimate, then forecast it with just the counts. And if they're equal, drop the one that's more effort. So if you're only doing story point estimation just for the forecast, you don't need to. But if you're doing estimate to make the teams actually talk to each other once in a while, and teach each other what to do, then keep doing it. Repeat the experiment once every 3 months, to make sure that you haven't moved into a different phase of the project where you've got a different size stories that might screw up your just plain old counts. So I'm on either side. Question?
Is there not an argument that the actual process of doing estimating?
Yep, that's what I sort of mentioned. Only drop it if you're only doing it for the forecast. If you like your teams to talk to each other and you're getting value out of doing those estimates, just do them fast. Here's the rule. You do every type of forecasting technique you have on hand. Everything you can do. If time or money is at stake and it's not your money, then you do as many forecasting techniques as you can, and then you average the result. Because they're all stronger in certain ways. So the point estimates will be stronger if you've got a really varying amount of high, medium, and low stories, and that changes throughout the project. That won't be caught just by using counts. But if you do, what counts tend to pick up in the throughput rate, it tends to immunize you against bad estimates, because those estimates might be wrong. So the throughput and the story point both have value under different circumstances. Forecast them both and pick the date between the two. That's the way of minimizing your error. So I see everyone getting emotional about it on Twitter. Don't stop if it was working for you. Here's an alternative if you want to use it. Now, where do we go from here? The next question that came up was, how much data do you need? It's a fair question. How much data, if historical samples, do you think you need to actually be to give a reliable forecast? Let me see if I can pull up this. Where's open? Where's the recent ones here? Sorry about this. I got the question. I should have pulled it up in the break. No, it's not going to have it. Yeah. All right. I'll have to do it the old-fashioned way. How much data you need comes down to, what you're trying to do is work out, when I get a sample, what's the chance that I can get another sample that's lower or higher than I've currently seen? Now, I need a sample from the crowd. Someone needs to come up here and stand right here. Someone sober. Okay. I'm going to need a couple more samples, so get ready, I'm going to call on you. Okay, now when I have one bit of data, there's an actual tallest person in the room which would stand against the wall, and an lowest person in the room who would stand against that wall. With one sample, can I tell anywhere about what the range is yet? No. I need another sample. So I want this person, if they're taller, to stand this side of you, and if they're shorter, to stand this side of you. All right. Okay. So, I don't need your sample yet. This is not employment history. All right, that's cool. I love the enthusiasm, but it's wrecking my flow. So, now we have two people. So we certainly have a range, a highest so far and a lowest so far, but we've got the lowest on the wall and the highest on this wall. What is the chance that our next sample will be a height between those two? Okay. A third, exactly. Right, now let's go through the working of that. There's exactly three spots that he could fit. He could fit over here, he could fit here, or he could fit here, balancing on the edge. So, because there's three possible spots, just like on that first page you did, there are three possible things that could happen here. And the chance that he's between the two would be, if we distribute the probabilities equally, 33%, 33%, 33%. So even with two samples, the chance that your next sample will be between these two is 33%.
But the fact that the length are different.
Unknowable to you. You can't know. So we make an assumption at the moment that it's completely uniformly distributed, even though we have evidence that they're, until we get the next sample, we don't know yet what the space is between them. So we're going to assume that there's an equal probability of each three spots. And I'll prove to you in a second that that actually turns out in real life as well, even though it's completely wrong. Third sample. You might have to shuffle over so we can fit where. Sorry, yeah. Now that was a sample of biased data. Sometimes people lie on survey forms or polls. How are you going to vote on Brexit? Yeah, things like that. So, okay, so now we have three samples. What's the chance that the next sample is between the lowest we've got so far and the tallest we've got so far? So we got this spot, 1, 2, 3, 4. Distribute the probabilities out of 100%. Each spot is worth 25%. So I got 25% plus 25%. So just with three samples, you've now got more than a toying cost or an equal toying cost chance that the next sample will be in here. It's exciting, isn't it? Can we find out? Another random sample. Someone has to stand up. I'll pick someone. I promise I will. Sorry. Yeah. We'll give it to you. It's fine. It's the hair, sorry. No, leave it up. Get on the other side of him. So we're ranked now from intelligence to height. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spots. 100 divided by 5 is? Chance that the next sample is between these? 60%. You're now more likely than not that your samples are between the range that you've seen. Now, I'll summarize this by saying, before you marry, date 7 people. Because by 7 people, there's only a 10% chance there's a worse dirtbag out there. And there's also only a 10% chance that there's someone better than what you know. Go back to the person you dated that was the best you had in those 7 samples and and marry them.
If you still have a likelihood.
Yeah, yeah, so leave on good terms. No. So that's, it takes very few samples to really start reducing, to understand the range of values. What we don't know with this number of samples is what the distribution is in the room. But for our purpose of forecasting and getting ranges, we don't need that. We're going to make this broad assumption that everything's uniformly distributed. So 7 samples. By even if you've got more data than 7 samples, throw it away. Throw the older data away, because the older data is more likely to represent a process that was had more people or less people or dumber people. You know, people are now smarter. So I see people wanting to get hundreds of samples and impress me by how many samples they have. To me, it just means that it's biased. So get your 7 samples and just be thankful for it. Thank you. So now to prove that one way. Oh, yeah. I mean, you could track it over time if you wanted to. Devs are so petulant that you really can't measure them like that. So your point is the fact that we should take more or we should...
Well, maybe you need to adjust for yourself. Yeah. Measure your capability against other external...
Okay, that's fine. Do that too. I'm just sort of saying that I see people rule out doing this type of technique using historical data because they say they don't have enough. And I don't believe that. Multiple team forecaster. Now, this was a spreadsheet I built about 5 or 6 years ago. And what it was trying to do was it grabbed all these teams' data from this big company. And I couldn't stop them during their quarterly planning stuffing 800 times more work into a plan than they could ever achieve. So I tried to give them a way of quickly assessing whether that was possible or not. And what it meant was during those quarterly planning meetings, when they try to overfill a team with more than they've ever historically achieved before, we could say, stop. So this is what this does. It's in those that download site. It has two different ways of working. I'm just going to show you one here because it proves my point. And what I did, I said 12 weeks, reserving 20% capacity for unplanned work. How many stories could team 10 get done? 79 stories. So by the time we'd allocated in the plan 79 worth of stories work for team 10, we could sort of say, unless you're going to change something, they're going to be the constraint in the process. So let's just go up here to team four. That's right. This team could only do 37. So what we're finding is, even though one team could do 85, one team could do 37, of course their stories were different size and granularity. They weren't equatable to each other, so you had to look at them in individuals. But let's look at this. So 37 stories for team, which team is this? Team three. So I come across to this tab. Team three has currently 25 pieces of data. So let's remember the date. Someone remember 37. Can someone do that? It's my age, minus 10. So I'm now going to delete everything except the first. I'm going to leave only 10 recent week throughput history. They had this big jury thing. All I did was I dumped the last 12 months worth of data, and I counted per week how many stories they had done in that year period of time. And that's what these numbers represent. 8 stories per week, 1 story that week, 5 stories that week, 3 stories, 2 stories, 8 stories. So that was just based on just the completed date of the stories, or the sign-off date of the stories. So what was that number I asked you to remember? So with 10, we would have done 33. Okay, it's not far off. Let me dump that down again to just 3. With 3 data points, 37. The thing is these teams end up with a pretty repeatable pattern in what their data actually is. So I would have got just the same estimate of the number of stories this team could do with 3 samples as 26 samples. Just to show it's not a fluke, let's change teams to another team. Someone want to pick one? Haven't tried 7. So this is off script, so hold tight. 105 stories. This must be a high-performing team. Team 7. So there we go. What was it? 105?
Yeah.
I don't know. Delete a few. Whoa. This team's a bit more unstable in their throughput, aren't they? You probably see they change trend there? See later in the day there, you sort of see that these samples are up in the 24s, but they must have been forming. So I'd say this was a new team that was forming. So it's not infallible. If you've got the data, have a look at it and do what I just did. And if you find a team where you can't just, where you need more samples, what really has to happen there is I need to take the most recent data, talk about breaking the suspense, and move it up there. So that was a classic case of overtraining. They actually changed profile, and you'll sort of see that I can have less samples, but I have to take the most recent less samples because they must have added people to the team or something like that. But it certainly didn't need 100, and it's certainly not that unstable that you can't run those little experiments and understand what it is. So that was an answer to the question about how many samples you need. 7 of the most recent samples will outperform whatever you do. Now remember, when we often give the forecast, we do it right at the beginning of the project where we don't have any samples, or we have last sprint samples and we don't really know whether the work's going to be similar going forward. If you have teams which are doing more reoccurring work flowing on from the previous release, they're going to forecast on this method even better. Teams that suddenly change, you hire a new MacBook wielding designer who says we need to use this new JavaScript framework, that you've never used before. Don't expect that your team which does APIs into the COBOL mainframe system will have the same sort of outlook on things. You gotta sort of borrow your data sort of carefully. So does that make sense? You don't need much data, and it can be pretty noisy. You see, there's nothing really even clean about this data. It's even the team which did well in this system, there's 12s, there's 1s, there's 2s. It's not about how consistent it is. It's about that the patterns continue and emerge, because a lot of teams have these cycles where they pull in a big piece of work, or they work long hours and then they die for a little while because they're trying to recover. You gotta sort of look after your team. So it's not about being stable, it's about being consistently unstable. All right. I have another spreadsheet. The people who just did my 2 days worth of training, they started tweeting that. They started tweeting, there's a spreadsheet for that. Right. A little bit more complex, this one. What this one aims to do is help you understand what can fit into a sprint now, or a release. So you've got these multiple features you could do. What this one does is it... you list your features, you list the story count, guess low and high for the features, and it looks at which ones will hit a particular target date that you specify. So the change up the top up here is you tell it that you've got a target date of 1st to the 7th. Now, here's what happens. When people ask you when something will be finished, refuse to answer. They've got a date in their mind already. They already know when they want it to be delivered. Tell them to spill the beans. Say, when have you told the customers they're getting it? Or what did the press release say? Or, how much do we find if we miss this date? There's always a date. That's always in someone's head. So when they ask us to forecast and we spend hours and days and weeks in a room, when we come back, the only thing they're thinking is that longer than I thought or shorter than I thought. They really don't want the date. They really wanted the date that they had in their head. What they want to know is what can they get by that date. So start from that basis. If they don't give you one, make one up. But never and say, we can fit feature 1, 2, and 3 in by the 1st of the 1st, 2015. That's how when I did this spreadsheet. Now what that's done is it's just done that Monte Carlo forecast for feature 1, use the end date of that as the start date for the next feature, use the end date of that for the start date for the next feature. But what this allows you to do is to sit down with your stakeholders and sort of say, oh, bummer, feature 4 and 5 are going to miss. And they sort of say, I really want feature 5. And you sort of say, well, what are you going to trade for it? What we do in forecasting software projects is not forecast the end dates. We forecast the start dates. It's the start date that we've got control over here. So that's this start order number is over here. So they say, well, we want feature 5 rather than feature 1. So we say, okay, let's make that starting number 1 and that starting number 5. You got feature 5. Is that okay? And they sort of say, well, it's okay, but I really wanted feature 1 as well. And you sort of said, well, if you trade it for feature 3, you're likely to get neither, because feature 3 is huge. You should split that puppy down. But I could trade your feature 2 for it. So then you actually come in here and you sort of say, I'll put that as 2 and that as 5. Now, this is what happens at the end of the projects anyway, just before that date. This is exactly what happens when you get those last minute, let's do some re-estimates and let's do some reordering, except you've already done half the work on feature 2 and now you're abandoning it. So what you're trying to do with these tools is get those uncomfortable conversations about prioritization earlier. And what you get to say is this isn't based on hearsay, this is based on the historical performance of this team. So don't go telling me to change our estimates or to change our, or just to work longer hours. This is what this team has repetitively been able to do in the last period of time, or last 7 weeks. You tell them that you've got more data than that, they may not believe you. They probably married the 130th person they dated, so they don't know what you know. All right. So this is what we're trying to do. All forecasting is about, whether it's weather forecasting or software forecasting, it's about being able to point at a pretty map on a screen. It's about the communication, about helping people understand they don't need to know how it worked and how you arrived at it. They just need to know that someone got dressed up to go on TV to present it. So it's about having these discussions earlier when you still got time to do something about it. So that's sort of a couple of things we've sort of done there. All these tools are freely available. It's used in every other industry except ours. It used to be used more in the 70s when I was born. It's just gone out of vogue. We just stopped doing these things. We started using story points and then deciding that it was good, and then we still complained that we didn't hit our project deadlines. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I know which one we're going to do. You got a pond. Everyone have a pond here in their house? Anyone? You have a pond? Okay. Imagine it's your pond. We need to count the fish in, what's your name, sorry? Anna's pond. We can't kill the fish. I was in Texas and they just said we'll just pump action shotgun into the, you can't drain it, you can't do it. So there's something we used to do in the 70s as well. It's sort of fallen out of vogue, off the radar here. But the way that biologists count fish in Anna's pond is they would fish for them, reel them in, tag them, throw them back in, go to the pub for a drink. Got to give fish time to swim around and remix in with all the other fish in the pond. Then they come back and they fish again. And they count the fish that were tagged earlier that they re-caught, and they count the fish that aren't tagged that they caught. And the ratio of those tagged versus untagged allows you to calculate how many fish are left in the pond, how many fish are actually in the pond in total. Now we do the same thing and can do the same thing with defects. So if you want to know whether you should do more testing or leave the beta trial out there a bit longer and if it's going to return dividends, this is how you could do it. Split the surnames of the people who got the beta test program, A to K, L to Z, something like that. You just got to split, have two different groups. And then record when they email or complain about the defects they found, make good note of the defect and say whether it's found by group A and also if it's found by group B. Now it works like this. If you were reading a paper, I gave it to two different people and they were reading the paper and they come up with the grammar errors, it's my paper, lots of grammar errors, lots of passive voice, lots of aggressive voice. So they read through and they mark up all of the my wife's from Boston, she's the aggressive voice, but I don't know if that translates here. But they get all of if they get identical the same errors, the same number and the same errors, what's the chance there's more to be found in those two bits of paper? They both found the identical number and errors. Complete overlap. If two independent people looked and read something and found only the same errors, chances are everything has been found. If they both found a large number of different errors, chances are more looking will just yield more errors. And the same thing happens with software. So if you can get people reporting defects, you can sort of come up with an estimate that this estimate is, even though 7 defects have been found so far, we think by values of the overlap that there's still 3 undetected defects. Now this allows you to get a bit of a feeling about whether you could go live now or whether you should wait a bit longer. And the way you can do it in your company is if you do bug bash days. Does anyone do bug bash days? Yeah, where the developers go in, everyone tests, and they try and log as many defects as possible. All you have to do is get everyone to report every defect they find. Split them into two different groups. Group A, group B, you just assign them. They don't even need to know they're in a different group. You just need to say, just log everything that you get. Now, if there's a lot large overlap with what those groups find, chances are you've got most of your defects logged. If there's very little overlap in what they find, chances are you've got a quality issue that you need to keep sorting through. Now, this is how, when you move to continuous release, you can start solving some of the deployment risks by abbreviating and shortening your test cycles, because you can start understanding whether there's a large number of defects still remaining to be found. Question?
Sorry, yeah, question. Going back to Tom's analogy.
Yes.
What about baby fish?
Were they baby fish when they first fished, or were they baby fish after they've...
During that time, you're
not... No, you're not. That's true. Yeah. So they're tiny fish, so they're not going to be caught the first time. So they might be, you might underestimate the number of fish in the pond based on the small ones. Well, you really don't have a lot of choice other than maybe using a net, a small, fine net rather than a fishing rod. You've got to use a testing technique that's going to capture the bugs which are in the list. So you wouldn't...
Even the most basic stuff, like, I don't know, full stops missing.
Yep. Yeah, you have to. I gave you a couple of qualifying statements up here. This is the quest. These are what I think are the. I've seen this go wrong. That's why I'm over here doing workshops rather than in the US. So the question is have you test? You've got to ask these people, like, oh, look, you know, you went in and you fished that pond. Now, have you fished thoroughly enough that you feel the majority of issues have been found? I've seen this go wrong in games. Games have a linear sequence of play. So if you abbreviate the testing process, they only get to a certain point. So there still might be defects after that point. So if you're doing a checkout path and you don't let them go all the way through the checkout path to find those defects, this will calculate it wrong. Just like your baby fish. You're not going to capture those defects you haven't been able to capture first. And then you ask them just, you know, how surprised would you be if another group found double the issues that you found? In other words, you're not a man, you need to keep testing. You know, these men over here, they found 100 defects. You know, what did you find? 50? 50? Really? How surprised would you be if this analysis only found a few latent defects? So, in other words, you've got to ask people, do they feel like they've done a thorough enough test that they've found things that are there? If you do cut it short early, it's going to give you the wrong answer. But at the moment, does anyone have any estimate of how many unfound defects are in their code? So even if you're wrong, you just got to be consistently wrong is my motto. So if you use this and you do this on a repetitive, reoccurring basis, then you actually should be able to use this number as a barometer of release quality. Even if it's wrong, it'll wander up and down. But if your process is similar each time, you can use it to gauge whether this release is healthier or unhealthier than a previous release. Make sense? So that's, I think I bored you all to tears. So the thing about this, the stuff, that website I said earlier, let me find where it is, it's GitHub, ignore this. There's Canvas and Forms, exercises, presentations, and spreadsheets. Can you guess what's in spreadsheets? But Canvas and Forms is an interesting one, and this is my long-term memory. What we just did was latent defect estimation. Everything I've spoken about tonight has a one-pager. Because I drink a bit, I have no short-term memory. This is my memory. I print these out and I put them on people's desks so I don't have to explain to them what matters. And this will go through the process, the formulas, give you a bit of history, how to set it up, and a bit more detail than I've gone through tonight. But there's a lot of stuff in there. And you know, I can't force you to look at it, but there's stuff in there about dependencies. You know, how dependencies hurt teams. You often get hit by what can I do about dependencies or not. There's a cheat sheet for that. And all this is hard-won knowledge that every time I come up with something, oh, here's the one about why you should marry the 11th person you date. If you want to know the numbers behind that, prediction intervals, either Google it or go to this sheet. This will tell you exactly what we did with height up here on the stage. And the only other one I'll show you is backlog prioritization. This started as a Twitter argument. Someone said safe sucks. Someone said, how dare you say safe sucks? I say Scrum sucks. And someone said, no, Kanban sucks. Someone said, can't we all suck? So then I managed to sit down and find out all the different ways the backlogs were prioritized by cost of delay and way to short a job first, and documented the arguments here. And all I want to leave you with, there's no right answer here. Doing it the ways on the left, you have a chance of suboptimal ordering decision, but they're very fast. Things on the right, you will probably go bankrupt trying to implement on a large scale. The answer is never at the edges. If you ever see no something or always something, it's wrong in biology, it's wrong in science, it's wrong in our field. So there's always, you got to pick how much you're willing to invest to reduce the chance of getting a suboptimal decision. And you've got to do your own research and pick your own sort of pathway through it. But just use a little bit of math when you do it. That's all I ask. And with that, I'll stay around and do the exercises. The exercises are made to be sort of done by yourself anyway. You've got the printouts of them on your table there. They're not surprisingly under the exercises folder. So if you wanted to print them out and do them with your own company, they all just use dice, and they're all just trying to teach one concept I've gone through tonight and to give you a bit of practice about getting. It's not so hard, it's just rolling dice. Anyway, thanks for inviting me.